Good morning, everybody. It's good to see faces. It's good to talk with you in person. And there are more chairs over here. There are chairs. If you don't have to sit if you don't want, but if you'd like to sit, then you can do that. We're thankful for the weather that we have. Extremely thankful for Monica and Sam letting us invade your property. And just a quick glance at next Sunday's weather shows 75 degrees. So, yeah. So if you can bear this, we'll be back Sunday. So why don't we pray together? And I'll invite you, if you want to stand and worship with us, by all means, please do that. And let me say this too. Here's what we're doing. Because there are people right now that are looking for the live stream link, because we told them we would do it, but we couldn't get connected to Facebook, to any data. We've tried AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile, and then even Wi-Fi just now. I couldn't get connected to the Wi-Fi. So anyway, it's not meant to be for that, but I am recording, so we're going to stream this afternoon, so for those that can't be here. And so the reason I'm saying that is, if any of you happen to be able to get a little bit of service sometime during the service today, if you could post a message saying, hey, Oasis is happening, but it's going to be later this afternoon for those of you that aren't here live, that would be nice. Otherwise, they'll just be patient. They'll be pleasantly surprised that it's actually going to show up this afternoon. So,
email.
Oh, yeah. And I sent, if you can't see this very well, the lyrics up here, we sent the email out and the text messages out. If you received those, you should be able to pull those up on your phone as JPEGs and scroll through the lyrics for the songs that we're going to do.
And we definitely want you singing.
Absolutely want you singing.
We've been singing together for way too much time.
It sounds good in this valley. Let's pray together. God, thank you so much for giving us the freedom to worship you in this place. Out in the open, wherever it is we might be, we have the freedom in this country and this land to be able to give you the glory that you deserve. And we're grateful for that today. And we're grateful to be able to be together with friends and do that as your church, Lord. Just a small body of people here that are gathered as your family to just try to encourage one another, to bring comfort and strength and edification to other people who also say, hey, I love Jesus and I want to do my best to follow him as well. And so we pray that today that you would be blessed here in this time as we begin to sing. We're not here for us during this portion of the time. We just want to take the next 30 minutes or so and just completely focus our hearts and our minds and our voices and our everything we have on you. Not to receive, but to give. Because we know that when we give to you, Lord, you reciprocate that. And we end up walking away from this place even more blessed than we would have been had we come to receive. Father, we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right.
Again, God, I'm begging, please again, I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness, sing it out with us. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Dead men walking, slave to sin. I want to know about being born again. Oh, I need you. Oh, God, I need you. So take me to the riverside. Take me under, baptize. I need you. God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Sing that again. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. And I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey. Like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
It's like holy water.
It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless and awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You'd lay down your life. That I would set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back to order? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you bear my cross. You'd lay down your life. Then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 Lord. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You'd lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
I got shocked a couple times.
Yeah, I've been staying back from it.
Yeah. The mics are getting us.
Yeah, it's always fun when there's dew and there's electric. Yeah.
I wasn't used to it with an acoustic, but I guess there's electric.
No, it happens all the time. The carpet.
Woo! I got shocked pretty good with my Les Paul one time. I could actually see the spark in my lip. All right, I'm going to turn the volume up just a tad so we can step back. That's... That hurt. I went right into that bridge, I don't know if you can see it. All right. Yeah, there, sure there is.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come. Knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again.
Promise still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I see you do it again. I see you do it again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. There is my confidence. You've never failed. Let's sing that again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
I was wondering if there was anything that any of you would like for us to just express to God. Like, does anybody have just something that you want to share, like a blessing, a testimony, a personal thing that maybe God has been doing in you as in this really strange and unusual time that just seems to continue, right? Is there anything that you can give that's just good news or that you would love for us to hear that might be it might bless somebody else that's here?
Kind of seems like this place is a blessing.
It is, isn't it? Yeah. No doubt. There's sunshine on this side of the congregation.
It's your sweet wife, Sam.
That's right. That's why she's over there. It's not necessarily this. It's why this.
That's on fault too.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we're going to sing a couple more songs together before we open God's Word. And I'm looking forward to seeing what God does in His Word today. So.
I've searched the world. It couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and the treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. there's nothing, nothing is better than you. No, I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. The God of the mountains is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. There's nothing, oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. There's nothing better. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better. Turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Let's sing that again. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Let's shout that name in this valley, all right? Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Shine through the shadows. Break every stone, burn like a fire. Same exact spot. I messed that up in the same exact spot last week on the live stream. Let's sing that first line together. I just want to speak. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. I know there is peace within your presence, I speak Jesus. You know, Lord, it's that name that we find our identity, and that's exactly where we're going right now as we look again at the words of John, one of Jesus's greatest friends, when you were here walking on this very earth that you created. And one of the greatest witnesses that we have, eyewitnesses, to know who you are and to know how to get you into our lives and how to live the life that you desire. And so we pray that, right now, Lord, that your word would speak and that you would induce faith in us as we hear your word and as we think about it, as it gets into our minds and our hearts. We pray that, you would do your work by the same Holy Spirit that inspired the writing of the words that we're about to look at. We pray that we know he is here right now. We pray that he would come and he would change and rearrange our hearts, that you would break us open if we need to be broken open, and that you would rebuild us again. You would give us a new heart, that you would take out of out our hearts of stone, if there are hearts of stone here, and that you would give us a heart of flesh that would beat the blood of Christ, the life of Christ, that we would know today how to truly abide in him. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, get your Bibles out if you would. I need to highlight that section. Please do. Thank you. Yeah, there you go. That's right. That's exactly right. That's awesome. Yeah. And just so you know, this group of Christians does not deny science. So,
yeah.
I love science. God gave us
science.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. At some point, you can't prove it, and it's like, okay, science and faith connect. I love hearing testimonies like that, because the truth is, in the book of Revelation, we learn John, in fact, who authored the book of Revelation. John is a theme for us here. We've been in John, studying John for a while. But in the book of Revelation, it's in chapter 12, he describes, he's describing what is potentially going to happen, in the future. And he said that he saw, the battle between the beast, and he's describing how the beast is, the great beast, the enemy of God, Satan, is destroyed. And he actually gives two ways. And the first, most obvious way that we know is the blood of the Lamb of Christ. And he said they conquered him by the blood of the Lamb. And the second thing that you find in that chapter, he says, and the word of their testimony. And I always love to hear testimony, because what it does is it helps us, the rest of us, to conquer Satan in our lives as well. It actually has power from God to do that. And so that's why we're always definitely open to hearing the way God's working in people's lives. Well, we're going to step back from our study of 1 John. We're actually going to go to the Gospel of John. So if you're already in 1 John, you're going to need to take a left and flip back over to John's Gospel. So we're going to stay with him. But the reason I wanted to go to John's Gospel, and we're going to be in chapter 10, is because I want to study something that that is really supportive of what John has been showing us in his letter. And so we know John is an eyewitness of Jesus. And so what we're going to do is we're going to step away from the letter that he wrote toward the end of his life, the teachings that he gave to the church as he was very, very old. And we're going to go back now and look at more of what John saw and experienced when he was a young man following Jesus. And he was a much younger man at this time. But this is the words, and he wrote this later in his life, but he's recalling. So it's sort of like the memoirs of John, and we look at his gospel in the same way you see Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They have their journal, if you will, their elegy of their life and with Christ, or what they saw, what they heard from the witnesses that walked with Christ. Well, John was actually one of those eyewitnesses, and he wrote this stuff down. So we're going to go to John 10, and I just want to read this, because as I was thinking through some of the things that we've been talking about, that John has been saying in his letter about how he wants the Christians of that day and our day and every day, whatever generation comes after ours and all the generations that came before ours, to know that our identity is in the truth of who Jesus is. And when he describes the truth of who Jesus is, he's describing him as God who came to the earth that he created, not just in spirit, but in physical form, fleshly form, and at that time was fully man, but also still fully divine, fully God. And so what I want to do is I want us to look right now. We're just going to kind of go back, and it's not a huge detour, because it's not going to go far away from where we've been, but we're going to hear from Jesus as he tells us who he is, all right? There are a few times in the Gospels where Jesus tells people directly who he is. And that's a thing that I think some people don't understand that. There are actually really, really high-level academic scholars who actually teach theology in universities who say that Jesus never claimed to be God. And they've never read some of these stories then, because we're actually going to read one today where Jesus says, I am he. And he said it directly to the woman at the well in John chapter 4, as she's asking about worship. And he declares he tells her, the one that you are standing with and talking with is the Son of God. And so it's odd that people would choose to look over those times where Jesus did, in fact, claim to be God. So we're just going to look at one of those times today. Let's read this together in John chapter 10. And I still have not gotten, I need to get a larger ESV. I'm old. Can't see this hardly. So bear with me. Tra- Truly, truly, Jesus says, truly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. Well, this figure of speech, so now John's stepping in, and he's saying this figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and he will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. So remember a couple of weeks ago I talked about steal, kill, and destroy? I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. So there was again a division among the Jews because of these words. Many of them said, he has a demon. He's insane. Why listen to him? And others said, these are not the words of one who is oppressed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind? So, we are a people who worship Jesus Christ. So I just want to let that sink in, all right? Because there are still places in the world where that will get you killed, actually. We don't admire Jesus. A lot of people say, oh, you know, we don't admire him, or we don't follow him. I should say just admire him, just follow him. We don't just swear allegiance to him. We worship him. We worship him. We worship him as eternal, uncreated, omnipotent, all-wise, creator and sustainer and redeemer of this universe. So when we worship him, what we're saying is he is God. He is one with the Father and one with the Holy Spirit. And as we worship God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, one God in divine, three divine persons, we're saying Jesus is among him. We worship Jesus. This is the context for what we're about to look at here in those verses. So the verses that we just read, verses 1 through 21, are where we're going to spend all of our time here this afternoon, this morning. And I'll be honest with you, I'll give you a little secret. It's not really a secret, but here's the thing. It's the context for everything we ever talk about every Sunday and every church day. It's the context for how we choose our songs that we sing. It's the context for every aspect of church life. It's the context for private life, your individual life, all of life. If you call yourself a Christian, that's the context. We worship Jesus. That's the context. So before Jesus' words here that he gave us in this chapter, something must have happened, because at the end of this chapter, or at the end of this, not the end of this chapter, but the end of the section that we just read, someone said, well, these are not the words of one who is oppressed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind? Well, what's he talking about, open the eyes of the blind? Well, actually, in chapter 9, so the chapter before this, something really fascinating happened in chapter 9, and we should talk about it. We should at least paraphrase it and summarize it so that we understand what's happening in chapter 10, because in all honesty, chapter 10 is a carryover of the conversation that was happening based on what just took place in chapter 9. So there's really no break between chapter 9 and chapter 10. So as Jesus is walking along the road, this is in chapter 9, he passes a man who was born blind. And so he's walking with his disciples, and his disciples see this man who's out, you know, sitting along the road there, often begging along the road, and they make an assumption about this man based on, I guess, some, you know, their belief about God. And the question they asked Jesus was, well, who sinned? Was it this man? Why is this man blind? Is it because of his own sin, or maybe his parents sinned, and therefore they cursed the parent? God cursed the parents with a blind son. And Jesus answered them by saying this. He said, it was not that this man sinned or that his parents sinned, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. It's a fascinating thing. And I love that answer, because what it tells me is it reminds me of the sovereignty of God. It reminds me of, just because this man's circumstance seems really, really bad, does not mean that God is not working in that circumstance, that God is not doing something good in this blind man, or about to do something good, and this is the appointed time as he meets Jesus. So after saying that, Jesus walks over to the ground, and he spits on the ground, okay? And he makes, this was before the days of COVID, so he spit. Always got to get a COVID joke in there somehow. And it's nothing to joke about. I shouldn't say that, but we have to smile or else we'll go nuts. And he rubs some dirt into his palm to make mud. And then he wipes it on this man's eyes, this blind man's eyes. And he tells him, so go to Siloam and wash your face. And when the man does, he goes to Siloam, and he washes off his face. And when he opens his eyes, he's actually able to see for the very first time in his life. He had never seen before. He was able to see for the first time. It's an incredible scene, and just a really everyone was amazed. In fact, it created such a stir among all the people that they wanted to know who did this. And the reason why they wanted to know, here's another weird thing, which we've talked about this a few weeks ago. We went through the Ten Commandments on Remember the Sabbath, is because the day that Jesus did this just happened to be the Sabbath day. Well, the Jews had created all sorts of rules. The Pharisaic Jews created all sorts of rules of things that they should and shouldn't do on the Sabbath that were not God's rules. They misunderstood what it meant to keep a Sabbath, but they wanted to know, because anyone who would work, do any kind of work like this, or heal someone on the Sabbath was a blasphemer. And so they said, who is the one who did this? He's a sinner, and he has blasphemed the name of God for healing this man on the Sabbath day. And so they asked this man that was blind, but now he can see, to describe exactly what happened. How Jesus is a sinner because he healed you on the Sabbath. And this man looks at the Pharisees, and he gives them a really great answer. He says this, whether he's a sinner or not, I do not know. But one thing I do know, that I was blind, and now I see. There's a testimony, right? That's all it takes. That's all it takes to tell someone about Jesus is, look, I don't know all the answers to your questions about the scriptures. I don't know everything, but here's what I know that he's done in my life. That's really all it takes. So take that. That's a little lesson. Every now and then we get these little lessons. That's not the main one. We're going to get to the main one. Well, the Jewish leaders get mad at him because he won't denounce Jesus, right? And so they cast him out. And toward the end of chapter 9, this man's cast out, and Jesus goes and finds him after he'd been cast out. And they have this really phenomenal exchange with one another at the end of John chapter 9. And I'll just read it. Jesus heard that they had cast him out. This is verse 35. And having found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? And he answered, and who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Hang on one second. Does Jesus ever claim to be the Son of God, the Son of Man, another term for the Christ? Here it is. Write it down. John 9:37. Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you. And he said, the blind man said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. This is a beautiful story of salvation. Jesus heals a man who, by the way, did not ask for healing. This man didn't. Jesus comes to this man who did not ask for his presence. Jesus invades this man's life, much like he did with some of you. Many of you probably weren't asking for Jesus' presence in your life, but through something, some circumstance, some family member, some event, something happened, and now you believe. And that's often how what he does. He invades this man's life, and he grants this man faith by declaring his identity, who he was, and the result of that is that Jesus is worshiped. So think about the whirlwind of a journey that this man has been on. He went from utter blindness to being able to see in one day, not just see, but see the blazing glory of the deity of Christ. I mean, that's what he saw. Is that thunder? Is that just noise? It's not supposed to rain, is it? Okay, good. We'll deal with it. So. Yeah, right? Yeah, take it up a notch. So as we read John 10, so as we get into John 10, here's the thing. There's only one conclusion that we can come away with regarding Jesus based on what he said about himself. And they say that at the end of this section of scripture that we read in John 10. And here's the conclusion. It's only one of two things. And C.S. Lewis puts it another way, but this is the way the Gospel of John puts it. He's either insane or he's God. C.S. Lewis says he's either a liar or he's a lunatic or he's the Lord. And John says, look, the people said this about him. He's either insane or he's God. It's got to be one or the other. That's verse 19 through 21 in chapter 10. So that's what it all comes down to. This Jesus that we worship is either insane or he's God, which makes us either insane or followers of him, worshipers of him, who are eternally saved in relationship with him. And the reason I say this is because the way Jesus describes his power in verses 17 and 18, I mean, you look at that and it's either insane or it's divine. There's no middle ground here. There's no middle ground then when he did this stuff. And honestly, there's no middle ground here now. This is what verse 17 says. For this reason, the Father loves me. Now listen to what he's saying. I mean, he continues this insanity. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. For I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Now, any mere mortal man, like myself, might be able to say, I have authority to lay down my life. I can lay down my own life. I can choose to commit a capital crime and my life's over. I can choose to jump off a cliff. I can choose to step between you and a bullet, save your life, give mine. We can all say, I have authority to take down, to lay down my own life. However, nobody can say, I have authority to take it up again. I mean, if I am dead, if you're dead, we can't undead ourselves. We don't have that kind of authority. We don't have the authority to make ourselves undead. But Jesus said that he could. So he's either insane or he's not just a mere man, mere mortal man. So this is where Jesus is taking us as he walks through this entire journey, as on this entire conversation here. He's either insane or he's God. So I want to follow him. I just want to kind of follow him through this story. And verses, you know, if you're unpacking this, if you like look at this and you study this and you want to write, like if you write in your Bible, this section really kind of falls into three parts. Verse 18, or these 18 verses, the first 18 verses, because the verses 19 through 21 sort of is the response there at the end. But the story, the main thrust of it, as you notice, are two big paragraphs there. And I would say verses 1 through 6 is the first part, and then verses 7 through 10 is the second part, and then verses 11 through 18 is the third part. And verses 1 through 6 kind of put the Pharisees to the test again with what John calls a figure of speech. He says Jesus said these things as a figure of speech. It's kind of a parable or a word picture, and it's kind of a general, you know, where general statement where Jesus is talking about things like sheep and a sheepfold and a door and a shepherd and a gatekeeper and a stranger and things like that. And in those section of verses, Jesus doesn't really identify with any of those things specifically, does he? He doesn't mention those things as something that he is he just kind of leaves the conclusion up to the Pharisees. He's speaking metaphorically right there, as John says. So then in verses 7 through 10, if you look at the way these verses begin, he says very explicitly, "I am the door." And then he unpacks what that means for us. And then in verses 11 through 18, he says very explicitly, "I am the good shepherd." And then he unpacks what that means for us. So one way to sum up these three parts would be to say that, well, in verses 1 through 6, Jesus is gathering a flock of sheep, right? He's gathering a people, I mean, metaphorical sheep, people for himself from the Jewish fold. And then verses 7 through 10, he's explaining why he's gathering this flock, that they might have life and have it abundantly, verse 10. And then verses 11 through 18, he's explaining how he's going to give life to this flock of people that he's gathering, these people that he's gathering, and he's going to give that life to them by laying down his life for them and then also taking it up again. So that's the summary, right? But there's so much more going on in this message. So let's follow. Let's listen to him here. So remember, he's talking to the Pharisees here, okay? Now there are other people listening. So there are people, it's kind of like a crowd, his disciples are with him, but Pharisees confront him, and then you got this blind man that he had healed, and they're all around. So they're kind of all around, and there's this scene where he's speaking and everyone's around. So what I want you to do, and I kind of gave this away already, is look at the bridge between chapter 9 and chapter 10. There isn't one. So there is, you can't find the bridge there, right? Chapter 10 just continues right on. It's the same conversation. So I really wish there was no chapter break here. So this is how it really should read. Okay, so let's begin with 9 verse 40. Some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, "Are we also blind?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say, 'We see,' your guilt remains. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in another way, that man is a thief and a robber." So there's no break there. It's unmistakable what Jesus is talking about. The Pharisees are the thieves and the robbers. They got their positions of shepherd-like authority, shepherd-like leadership, without the blessing of the gatekeeper. They weren't faithful shepherds. They're the stranger that he talks about in verse 5. He says, "A stranger, these sheep will not follow, but they'll flee from the stranger. They don't know the voice of strangers." The sheep that belong to the true shepherd, his own, as he says in verse 3, they will not be controlled by, as he's speaking to them, the Pharisees. But he says the legitimate shepherd comes into the fold with the blessing of the gatekeeper. And when he speaks, he knows his sheep and he calls them by name. And the sheep recognize his voice. And so they follow him out. That's what he says, verses 2 through 4. "He who enters the door, by the door, is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name. He leads them out. When he has brought out his own, they go before him, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice." So even though Jesus in these verses never actually says he is the shepherd, it's plain from the context of what happened in chapter 9 that this is what Jesus is talking about, that this is all the same conversation. So Jesus has just called this blind man to himself, and he's made him a worshiper, and the Pharisees should have been serving this man, but they weren't. They claim to have authority over him as shepherds, but they did not care for that sheep. And this is the word picture that Jesus is giving. And so the point of verses 1 through 6 is Jesus is gathering a flock. Jesus is gathering people out of the fold of Israel. He calls his own sheep by name and he leads them out. And that's what Jesus was doing then. And that's what Jesus is doing today. This is happening in this very place where you sit today. While you're listening, Jesus, you're either hearing the voice of an insane man, as we read the words of Jesus, or you're hearing the voice of God. It doesn't change. It's the same. Just because we're in a day where we have a little more technology and we're a couple thousand years removed, it's not any different. So John calls this word picture that Jesus is speaking a figure of speech. So why did Jesus tell this to the Pharisees? What was he doing here? I think he was testing them. He was giving them another chance to show if they were really blind or not. Because remember what he said at the end of chapter 9? He said, "You say we see." Well, okay. If you see, then you would know, right? And there are people who say, "Oh, I see. Well, if you see, so Jesus is like, "Okay, here we go. I'm going to draw a picture for you, and then you tell me what you see with this word picture." So this figure of speech Jesus used for them, John said, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. They didn't understand his figure of speech, so they couldn't see. Even though they said they could see, they couldn't see. And so now, because they were still guilty of their sin, they could not see, Jesus responds to their blindness, right? So on one hand, he keeps explaining. And on the other hand, you could say that as he keeps going, depending on your perspective of Jesus, I guess, you could say he makes himself look even more insane. So some people might read this and say, "Oh, okay, he's just explaining who he is." And some people might read this and say, "He's even crazier than we thought." Just depends on how you see him. And that's what's happening in this story, and that's what happens today. So people all around him, remember back in John 6, you may have remembered reading Jesus talking about being the bread of life. He's done this before. He does this a lot, right? And in John 6, they're kind of murmuring around and like, "What's he? How can he be bread from heaven?" Right? And then he goes even grosser. he makes himself look even more insane by saying, "Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me." And so when they gagged on that, he said to them, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it's granted to them by the Father." So in essence, he's saying, "Look, I am the only way to get to God the Father." And he's just continuing to just blow their minds. Oh, that's the mic. Just realize that. That's how good the Bose system is. It sounds like thunder. Yeah. So he's like, "Okay, you don't grasp my figure of speech about the sheep and the shepherd and the strangers and the thieves. So let's try this. I'm just going to tell you right out, right? I am the door and I am the shepherd." Well, right then the crowd divides. And you either believe that, you understand that, because it sounds like he's explaining it more, or you go, "Okay, he's totally nuts." One group of people say that's foolish. It's a double metaphor. Even looking at it, like with a rational mind, you can't be a door and a shepherd. Like the door is the way you get in, and the shepherd's the one that cares for the flock. But Jesus is saying he's both, right? So how is he both? Well, let's ask him and let's let him tell us, right? Jesus, tell us, how are you the door? How are you the shepherd, right? We want to know, okay? Tell us what it means for us today, what it means, what it meant for them, and what it means for us. So here's what it means. To those who are willfully blind, like the ones he was taught, like many of the ones he was talking to in that day, he only offers foolishness. And that's the same is true for today. I mean, if you're willfully blind to see who Jesus is, all it's going to look like is foolishness to you. And everybody who follows him and worships him as God will look like foolishness to whoever is not willing to see. But to those who are desperate to see, he offers hope. So what does Jesus say about his door, about being a door and being a shepherd? So let's look at being a door first. Kind of a weird thing. Jesus is a door. All right, what's it mean? Here's what he says, verses 7 through 10. "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers." So he's saying there have been others that claim to be able to give what only I can give. And he says, "But the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and he'll go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, but I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." So Jesus is saying the same thing that he will say here in a few chapters later that I already quoted in John 14. "I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. So he is saying, I am the door. If you believe in me, if you trust me to be the only path to God, I promise you two things. This is what he says in verse 9, two things. You will be saved, and you will go in and out and find pasture. So as we've been studying the letter of 1 John, we've seen a common theme that John wants us to see, and that is that we find our identity in Jesus. And last week we talked about abiding in him. And what I said was, you know, when you abide in Christ, it means you live there. I mean, when you live somewhere, it's like you take on that personality. You take on the characteristics of that community, of that town. Well, Jesus says, abide in me, live here, rest here, right? Not only does he make his home in your heart, he's saying, I want you to make your home in me, abide in him. And so I love the way he says here in John 10:9, you will be saved. You will be saved. So it's not just safe, right? But you will be saved from what? From wolves and thieves and those who come in to steal and kill and destroy. So safe from every enemy that would seek to destroy you. Enter by me, Jesus says, and you will be forever safe. Saved is the way he says it. And I love that because none of us, I think, wants to merely be safe. We weren't created to merely be safe, right? The human heart wants infinitely more than just safety. And honestly, I think it's why in the world, in what we're seeing today, as we live through this pandemic, there's a huge push for safety. But those who truly know they're saved are able to rest and find peace where safety cannot provide it. In fact, those who know me, I got a good friend Pat, and he and I came up with a list of words like this summer of words I was just tired of hearing. Like amid. Like every time you turned around, the word amid, A-M-I-D, amid. Every article heading said something amid the coronavirus, or amid this. So I'm like, amid, I'm canceling that word. I don't like that word anymore. And it seemed like every email I got from someone or every interaction I had from someone at the university, they would like say, I hope you're staying safe, right? Be safe, you know, stay home, stay safe. And I told Pat, I'm like, you know what? I'm done with the word stay safe. Stop telling me to stay safe. Now I'm going to get texts from all of you now. I know. Say, stay safe this afternoon, Chris. Okay. Would you just shut up, man? Am I the only one to watch that debacle? Okay. All right. We won't go there. Safety is basic and necessary. But, I mean, we all want to be protected from what can destroy us. But I think what we really want is life. We really want life, right? And if we're honest with ourselves, we want more than life. I mean, because that's what safety provides. Well, if you're safe, you can maybe save your life. But I think we want more than just life. We want abundant life. We want overflowing life. We want significant life. We want joyful life. We don't just want to survive. That's not what we're made for. You were made for abundant life. And that's what Jesus is saying. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. Yes, you'll be saved. And so much more. Because you will be saved. And what's the second thing he says? And we'll go in and out and find pasture. Well, what's that mean? Well, the point of saying that is this. The sheepfold itself represents safety. So if the sheep are in the fold, they're safe. They're protected. The sheepfold represents that. But sheep don't want to stay there. In fact, if they do stay there, they'll die in the safety of the fold. They want to go out and in. They want to go out and find green pastures so they can eat and run and exercise. They want to find refreshing waters so they can drink. They want to go out and in. It's not just about the safety of the fold. It's about finding pasture, abundant life. And I think when Jesus says in verse 10, I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly, he means I came that they may be saved and go in and out and come in and out and find pasture. Protection and plenty. Solid safety, but also deep soul satisfaction. Regardless of your circumstances, regardless of your trials, regardless of what kind of environment you might be living in at the moment, this is what Jesus offers. And I think we need to be really careful every time we read and hear about this word abundant life and having abundant life, not to read into it something that Jesus is not saying. Abundant life is not about having stuff, all right? Because there's a whole sect of Christianity that says that's what this word means, and it's just a false teaching. It's about having peace. It's about having joy. It's about having God. And so we sit here today and say, thank you, Jesus, for being a door to us, right? We believe that you're the only door to eternal safety, the only door not only to safety, but to the deepest soul-satisfying pastures, the only door to God. We enter through you. So that's what the being a door means, right? So he said two things. I am the door, and I am also the shepherd. So I want to say that before we conclude. That's the why. So here's the how, all right? So how are you gathering a flock of sinful sheep to have abundant life for all eternity? This is what he says in verses 11 through 18. And there's no way I'm going to be able to cover all this, and so I just want to simply follow Jesus really quickly to the end of this section, all right? So the short answer to that question is, what it means for Jesus to be our shepherd. So he says, I am the shepherd. He answers that question by talking about how he gathers sheep or gathering a people to have abundant life. And the way that he says that he does that is by doing what? I lay down my life for the sheep. He's laying down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know them by their name. I call them by name, just as the Father knows me. I know the Father. I lay down my life for the sheep. So he's bound to the sheep. He's bound to us just as much as he's bound to his Father. That's what it means when he says, I can no more lose one of my sheep than I can lose the Father. Think about that. In the same way that he is connected to God, he is connected to you, right? So Jesus says, verse 18, no one takes this from me. That's why he says it. No one can take it from me. I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down. I have authority to take it back up again. And this is the charge I have received from my Father. So the Father sent him to die for the sheep, and the Father commanded that he will never abandon the sheep, but he would rise from the dead, and that's the way that he never abandons the sheep. Because if he just laid down, if the shepherd just dies for the sheep, well, the sheep will die too. But if the shepherd is able to take up his life again and live, he can save the sheep. And that's what Jesus does. All right. Keep seeing that out of the corner of my eye. All right. So the peak of abundant life is the worship of Jesus Christ. And that's where he's been taking us as we've gone through this scriptural journey today, through John's letter as well in 1 John. Jesus says, I am the door and I am the shepherd. I have authority to lay down my life as a dead man. I actually have authority to take it up again. And by saying that, he is either insane or he is God. And John says, at the end of the Gospel of John, and also at the end of his letter in 1 John, all of these things are written that you may believe. That's what he says. So I pray that you will, in these difficult times of 2020, believe him, worship him, come to him as your door, as your shepherd, as your life. I want to tell you a story, and then we're going to take communion together. And so what we do as a church is we have communion set up normally on Sunday mornings with juice and bread, but we have these tables set up on two sides of the yard here, and there is a communion cup that has a flip thing that has a wafer on the top. So they're all, nobody has prepared it. They came in a box, so it's all safe. And we just sing to respond. We worship to respond to God's word. And this is the time. So we've been here as a community for, you know, almost 2 hours. But now this is God's time to deal with you individually, right? So now this is just going to be the Holy Spirit ministering to you as we work, as we respond to his word in worship. And we invite everyone who is a Christian to take communion, to have the Lord's Supper, as Jesus invited all Christians to do as often as we can. And so we can today, so we're going to. Yeah, we're going to take the wafer off the top of that cup. I think it's on the top, right? There's two little strips. And that wafer is unleavened bread that Jesus symbolizes, the bread that Jesus passed around to his disciples, but also even more so and more deeply symbolizes the fact that Jesus was saying to them that my body is about to be broken, and it needs to happen, and it's going to be for you. And then he passed around a cup of wine, and that bottom part is grape juice. And as he passed it around, he said, drink this, because everyone who drinks this is like taking part in my blood that is going to be the salvation provided for you, the propitiation for your sins, the appeasement of God's anger because of sin. And that has to happen. And so because of that being the central focus of what it means to be a Christian, he says, just keep doing this. For generation to generation, keep doing it as often as you can. And so we kind of combine communion with our response of worship at the end of the sermon. So I read a story one time about two men who were called upon in a large university classroom to recite the 23rd Psalm. And one of these men was a published orator. He was trained in speech technique and drama, and so he had a really powerful way of presenting anything that he would read. And when he finished reading the 23rd Psalm, the audience just exploded in cheers. And they even like were asking for an encore. They would read something else because he was just so powerful that they might hear his wonderful voice again. Well, then the other man, who was much older than the first man, got up and he repeated the same words from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. And he finished. But when he finished, no sound at all came from that large class. Instead, people just kind of sat in a deep mood of devotion and prayer and reflection. And after a few minutes, the first man, the orator, stood back up, and he said, I have a confession to make. He said, the difference between what you have just heard from my old friend here and what you heard from me is this. I know the psalm, but my friend knows the shepherd. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for being our shepherd, for being the one that is needed to care for us, to save us, that we might not just be safe resting in your presence, but that we might be able to go in and out and find pasture, that we might have abundant life, not just life. And God, we thank you for being our door, the open way, that there is no other rule, there is no other mediator needed to get to God, to get to that relationship that we so much long for, that it's just Jesus, and that's it. And that's why we worship Jesus, because he is the door, the way, the truth, and the life. So right now, God, we give to you the rest of our time.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to be. Your love made a way to live.
let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless down on us. You have made us new, and our life begins with you. Released from my chain, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom, faithfully bore. He canceled my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your end. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, when death was arrested and my life began, when death was and my life began.
I turned that volume up and your music was way too loud.
Yeah. We're going to sing one more together. I wish you guys could see this spider crawling around on my iPad. It's a little green. Wait, he's over here right now because he got out on the line. Like he was on the chorus of Death Was
like
Arrested.
Bouncing ball.
Yeah. He's just like doing this across the... Yeah, he's right there. There he is. All right. We'll go out with this song, okay? And again, Monica and Sam, thank you so much. Yeah. What a beautiful day. I mean, it's... And, you know, according to the forecast right now, next week looks good, so... We'll see. We'll just go with it. All right.
friend, Father, great is He, whom all blessings flow. O God of our salvation, from whom redemption comes, O Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed three in one.
Let's sing of the Son.
Behold the Son, our Savior, for our sin was slain. The price to purchase with His blood wretched souls of men. O God of our salvation, whom redemption comes, O Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed three in one. O God, the Holy Spirit, revealing deity, the fount of life and love divine throughout eternity. O God of our salvation, from whom redemption comes, O Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed three in one.
Out.
Ascribe, O church, the greatness and the glory to His name. One God, one being, one essence, O triune God, proclaim. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much for your provision for us today in giving us weather that we were able to meet out here together in the open and in the open air. And just so grateful for all of these connections, some old and some new, that we're making here today. And I just love the way you work. We're so grateful for we're not disappointed in what you've done in our church over the last few months, as we've been primarily online. I'm sure that we have grown in ways that we would not have otherwise, and that's just the way you work, that you find ways of bringing good in all circumstances for those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And we trust in that today, and we just will trust in it again as we go about this week and as we plan to be back here again next week. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Hey, thanks. Feel free to visit, and we're just going to slowly tear stuff down. So, cool.